cannot see.
Who's ready for the word of the Lord today? I didn't ask who wanted oxtails after church. I said, who's ready for the word of the Lord today? I need you to do me a favor. Keep playing that. Hey, hey, hey. Oh, 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 oh. I need, there's some faith-filled people in the room that need to make a move towards the altar. Listen, let me tell you why. Over the next 2 minutes, the altar is open for people with crazy faith to say unbelievable things that you're believing God to do before June 1st. Only people with crazy faith. I already told one couple, the Holy Ghost said, tell them, thank me for their house. And so I walked over, I said, do y'all have a house? They said, no. I said, the Lord told me to tell you to thank him for your house and to get to the altar and be specific. And the wife said, we just started looking. I said, well, you just got it because God told me that you have it, which means it's real when he says it, not when you get it. I need everybody to move towards the altar. Don't slip, don't stumble, don't falter. And if you need more room, I need you to move, move, move. I need you to get to the altar. If you slip, if you stumble, if you falter, it doesn't matter to me. Get to the altar, 'cause here is where there is victory. Oh, why are y'all so far away? Scoot up more so more people can get through the door. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh. Online, lift your hands up. In your house, lift your hands up. Matter of fact, won't you stand up? 'Cause God's giving you a hand up. Everybody at home, stand up. Throw your hands up. Stand up. Yeah, I'm talking to the folk at home. Don't you just sit down on your chair. Look at us, say, look at them up over there. You a part of this too. Because every word that God says is true. Lift your hands, tell the Lord that you bless him. Lift your hands, tell the Lord that you bless him. There is nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like the Lord. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like the Lord. Because he's always making a way. If you believe it, say, always making a way. You sing it. Put it in the chat feed. Put it in the chat feed. Always making a way. No matter what you need and no matter what you've been through, always making a way. No matter what you've been through, no matter what you're going through, always God's word is very true. Stand on his word, stand on his promise.
Always making a way.
Even when we do wrong, even when we stray, he's
always making a way.
Even when I mess up, even when I stray, he's
always making a way.
Sometimes I do right and sometimes I forget to pray, but
always making a way.
He always making a way. He
always making a way.
He's always making a way. as a point of faith, lift your hands. Jesus, for every hand lifted, this is a sign of faith. Before the message, will you do miracles, signs, and wonders in the lives of those whose hands are lifted and whose hearts are open? I pray by the power of the Holy Ghost that you would begin to move by your Spirit through this congregation in meaningful, substantive, supernatural ways, establishing the Lordship of Jesus Christ, the preeminence of the Holy Spirit, the authority of the throne of God, and the power of the Word active in our lives. Now, Jesus, seal this moment, and may we seal it with a praise of faith, hope, expectations. And for some of us, the tears that we're shedding are tears of release, tears of relief, and tears of faith in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen. I need you to lift up a sound. I need you to shout to God. You and the people around you, you and your house, you and your family, you and your row, you and on your way back to your seat. If you believe that what you just did at the altar actually changed something, would you respond? Would you react like it is finished? Chapter 12, starting at the first verse. For those who are not a part of this church or you're not a member of this church, we stand for the reading of God's word out of respect for the holiness of Scripture. Unless you're holding a baby, which I see you're holding a baby, you didn't have to stand up. You holding a baby. You could have sat down. You got the baby. You can sit down and you got baby hairs. So you got baby hairs and you holding a baby. Everyone else who has the ability to stand, please stand. Hebrews chapter 12, starting at the first verse. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded, tell somebody you're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. The people who died before you, Grandma, Auntie, Granddaddy, Big Mama, my dear, Mama, Daddy, siblings who died in faith, who died under the blood, are a part of the great cloud of witnesses. You need to know you're still on the field. They're in the stands. They got a luxury suite. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, watch this, let us lay aside every weight, and the sin which so easily ensnares us. Freeze. There's a difference between weight and sin. Some stuff can weigh you down, other stuff will get you sent to hell. You got to know the difference between the two. Some stuff is just heavy, but you can address heavy. Sin, the blood is the only cure for sin. Sin is a virus in the blood. In the same way you got a COVID booster and a COVID shot, and you got measles shot and a tetanus shot, because those things block viruses or stop progressive disease, the blood of Jesus is the only thing that can stop the progressive disease of sin in your body. It's scientifically proven that the blood of Jesus is the only proprietary substance that can eradicate the effects and the eternal consequences of the sin nature. I'm preaching already. Lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run. Tell somebody it's time to run. Run with endurance the race that is set before us. Here we go. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Romans 8:28. And we know that most things, some things, the things that we think, all things work together for good. I don't care if it felt good or not, it was working for your good. The breakup hurt, it was working for your good. Didn't work out at the last job, but you kept your heart pure and you were on time and you walked with integrity. It's not on you. It didn't feel good, but it's working for your good. We know that all things work together for good to those who love God. It ain't gonna work for you if you don't love God. So this is not for anybody who just wants to do what you want and think it's going to work out. No, you can't lie and cheat and connive and gossip and tear people down and then smile in their face and be all up, all extra lying and carrying on and think it's going to work out well for you. It's not going to work out well for you. It's only going to work out well for those who love God. I'm tired of everybody manipulating scripture to fit your life. You can't live how you want and get the promises of God. To those who are the called according to his purpose, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed. Watch this, conformed to the image of his son. Conformed, that means to be fit, to be fashioned, almost like a cookie cutter. If there is a metal cookie cutter, you put that there, then you pick it up, you put it there again, you pick it up, you put it there again. Each time the imprint goes down, the same cookie is made out of the dough. The problem is some of us don't want to be made. We want to make ourselves. Adding ingredients the Holy Ghost never intended. Coming out of the heat too soon. Now you're soft and gooey. He predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that Jesus might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. So I got the call, but I didn't get the call in real time. I got the call in his mind. He predestined me for what I'm doing right now before I was even a thing. God's been thinking about me for billions of years. It was just now that he needed me in the earth over the last 50. And God was waiting to unleash me on the earth until the earth needed me. The same way the earth needed you. You are not optional or accidental. You are exactly where you're supposed to be at the time you're supposed to be there. You weren't supposed to be born in the 1800s or the 1300s or 5,000 years ago. You were purposed for this moment, this day, with your personality, your testimony, your swag, your tears, your pain, your triumph, your tragedy, your truth, your conviction, your testimony. God wanted you here right now. You're exactly where you're supposed to be. Those whom he predestined, he also called. Whom he called, these he justified. You can't justify me. You can't disqualify me. You didn't call me. You don't have the luxury because God didn't give you a pen. He gave you a chair. So sit down and watch what he's doing in my life, because you can't stop anything that he wants to do. Whether you wish me well or wish me hell, it don't matter, because everything in my life is gonna line up with the will of God. I wish I had some help in here. I don't care who loves me or who doesn't like me. It has no bearing on what God's going to do in my life, with my life, through my life, and for my life. So you can either be a participant or an observer, but one way or the other, I'm going up. Whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified. Glorification is a process whereby which you are illuminated in a way that people either are repelled by you or drawn to you. In this season, don't be upset with the people that are repelled by the fragrance that you carry, because that's not your cologne, that's heaven. That's the Holy Spirit. It's the anointing. So the anointing does two things. It attracts and it repels. It will attract the right people and it will repel the wrong people. So don't change who you are. Stay in the anointing so the fragrance of your obedience will bring everyone into your life that belongs and will kick everybody out that is not supposed to be there. I need you to say two things to two people in this room, and I need you to type these two words in the chat feed. Hello, goodbye. It's hello for some of y'all and goodbye for the rest of y'all. It's welcome to a miracle for some of y'all and peace. Don't let the door hit you where the good Lord split you for some of the others. I need you to get a hello and a goodbye in your spirit. Hello to my future, goodbye to my past. Hello to my joy, goodbye to my pain. Hello to my freedom, goodbye to my bondage. Hello to financial freedom, goodbye to debt. Evan, get up. This is for you, boy. You wasn't singing that good to sit down. I need you to elbow three people. Hello, goodbye. Just hello, goodbye. Hello, goodbye. And while you're doing it, ask them, which one are you? Which one are you? You staying or you going? That's what my grandmother used to say when I would leave the door open. You staying or going? Make up your mind. Don't be standing in the door. Choose ye this day. You're not gonna let all this good air out of my house. I got this window unit in here. I got the aluminum foil on the sides, keeping the mosquitoes out. Hello, goodbye. So whether you stay or go doesn't make me any difference. I've got a purpose. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. He also predestined, those he predestined, he conformed to the image of his son, conformed to the image of his son, a finished work, a finished product. All right, okay, so then there was one more scripture. Can y'all stand to have one more scripture? Go to John chapter 19. Hurry, you gotta hurry. John 19, this is fast. John 19, you got to hurry, you got to go. You gotta go to the 28th verse, John 19 and 28. Jesus is on the cross, completely naked, beaten beyond recognition. His face is swollen beyond the ability to make out his facial features. All the movies that you've seen pale in comparison to the actual scientific, horrific torture that Jesus endured for the sake of your soul not to go to hell. It's real quiet in here. I'm gonna say that everything he went through is so you don't go to hell. He was never going. but Jew and I were on our way. So he had to get bust in his face, cat of nine tails on his back, crown of thorns on his head. He was the one that had to endure that slap by soldiers that he created. And they blindfolded him while they slapped him, and they said, prophesy to us, who slapped you? He could have messed him up and was like, Malchus, Romulus, Remus. He could have said it because he knew them all. Just because you got his eyes covered with a physical garment doesn't mean you can stop the vision of Jesus. But the Bible said he opened not his mouth. They lied on him. He kept his mouth closed. They called him everything but the Son of God. He kept his mouth closed. So why do you keep trying to convince people who already know when they talking they lying? So why are you trying to convince them? Keep your mouth closed and just keep serving God. Because I promise you, on the other side of crucifixion is resurrection. Now, I don't know what's on me today, but I feel a power on me I've never felt before. And it's time for some of us to get that thing off of us that's been trying to hold us hostage to a lesser version of who God intended for us to be. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. John chapter 19, 28th verse. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. Sour wine and hyssop. Sour wine and hyssop. That's a whole nother message. I'll do that one for leadership. Now, I'm not going to do that for this morning, because they don't know that when David said, purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me and I'll be whiter than snow. Hyssop has medicinal properties that actually take away sickness and disease. But the sour wine is symbolic of a covenant drink, but it's bitter to the taste. And so Jesus had to take sour wine so you could drink the good wine. Purge me with hyssop. So they gave him the sour wine, which is, this part of my assignment hurts and it tastes bad, but it is as much a part of the covenant as every other thing I've done. I've got to do this to actually validate and authenticate all the other miracles I've done. If I don't do this, then all the other things I did won't matter. So give me the sour wine. Let me finish what you started, Father. Ooh. Watch this. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, when he received the slaps from Roman soldiers, the crucifixion of a Roman cross because of insecure Jewish leadership who were too intimidated by a real man, a real servant, that they had to kill him because he loved people too well. There are people who can't stand you, and it's not because you did anything to them. It's because you love them and they hate themselves. And so they don't know how to take you because they hate themselves and they don't know why you don't too. So Jesus had received the sour wine. He said, it is finished. And y'all thought I was trying to be dramatic, but if you read, there's an exclamation after that. He didn't say it soft. He didn't say it tender. He didn't say it is finished. Like that song from 3LW, promises, promises, numbers and numbers. You got a lisp in the song, but don't have one in real life? All right. He didn't say it is finished. After being beaten for hours, bleeding out, and everyone significant in his life having left him, and the one closest to him betrayed him with a kiss, and he said, it is finished. And it says, and bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. The cross didn't kill him. Satan didn't kill him. Sin didn't kill him. He bowed his head, said, I'm done, devil. I give my spirit back to the one who gave me my assignment. I bow my head. His final act of worship, bowing his head. When we're in the presence of God, we bow our head. Jesus bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. I wish some of us would bow our head and give up our spirit back to the God who made us in his image. He declared, it is finished. The title of my message for the few moments I have with you today is The Finisher. The Finisher. You may be seated. The Finisher. This thing feels real good. The Finisher. Lord, help me. Therefore, since we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. My race is not your race. We might be racing on the same side of the street, but my race is not your race. I don't have to run at your pace, because your race is not at my pace. Your race is at your pace. But the pace for our race is the grace pace. I need to be running my race firmly in the grace of God, firmly in the grip of heaven. I need to be moving at the pace of heaven, not at the pace of people. I'm not here to impress you. I'm not here to make you think I'm more spiritually mature than I actually am. I'm not here to make you think I'm deep on Sunday mornings. I'm trying to get to heaven for real when nobody else is around. I'm not here to smile in front of a camera and cheese and coon and hope you like me. No, I'm fighting for my own soul salvation, because I know how easy the enemy can come after somebody and how easily you can get taken off of your game. I'm not the only person in here that truly loves God, but has truly made some stupid decisions, because the reality is I am flesh and spirit. I'm both. I'm not either or. And as long as I'm in a body, I'm going to have flesh. And as long as I have flesh, I'll have failures and I'll have carnality and I'll have limitations. But that's why the spirit has to be fed daily, and even more so than the flesh, so that your spirit tells your flesh what to do, not the other way around. Now, I need some folk over here to wake up, sit up, stand up, and don't make me come over there too. I need some folk at home to sit up, lean in on the edge of that couch, and get this word. We have been duped into a lazy spiritual existence that prioritizes Sunday church attendance, but not Monday through Saturday discipline. Let me tell you that there are some disciplines that are worth the stretch. For you all that are here this morning in the physical building, I want to take a moment to say thank you, because I know how hard it was for me to get out of my warm 1 hour less of sleep bed and get up and come to a building when you could have just turned on your computer. But for some of us, we knew that getting to the house was an act of faith that says, God, I'm putting you first. I'm going to do my best to get. Am I talking to anyone? And to those who are online right now, who could choose to be anywhere, digitally or online, there you can church surf all day. You don't like one, you just click over to your next favorite preacher. And when they start talking about offering, click them off and come back to us, because that's what folk do. But here's the thing, you can't eat from everybody's kitchen. Because everybody don't wash their hands when they cook. Everybody doesn't hear from the Holy Ghost when they cook. So you might want to stop eating off everybody's plate, because everybody ain't cooking fresh food. I need an 8-second praise break. I said I need an 8-second praise break to God, to God, to God, to God. All the way at the top balcony, I triple dog dare you to give God 8 seconds of praise. On your mark, get set. Set it off. If it doesn't cost you anything, it's not going to get you anywhere. The young brother who's here, Fly Guy DC. He is going to be one of the most significant voices in arts, media, and entertainment anywhere in the world. Over the next 5 years, he will become a global household name. He will be a global household name. He is an eight-figure man. He is already moving like a boss. And God put something in my spirit, and I spoke it to him. He does not live in the city. And I spoke some things that's gonna stay between me and that good brother. But here's what's crazy. His schedule is such that he flew from Miami back to Atlanta, had two events, didn't finish till 4 a.m., and then got a car service to drive from Atlanta so he could be here this morning after having one less hour of sleep than he would normally get. So if you live down the street and you struggling, bless you. But when you work till 4, got a car service so you could be at church 2.5 hours away, you are believing that God's about to do something beyond your wildest imagination. And I want you to know that God moves. When people start moving on faith like that, God's like, Yo, God is like, DC in the house. Watch your mouth. Oh, God is actually looking for some crazy faith people that start moving outside the box. Imagine how you would feel if you gave everything you had to a bunch of ungrateful individuals who only acknowledge you when they need something. And then you only ask them for a couple hours on a Sunday to come see about you, and they live down the street in the house that you gave them, in the bed you gave them, with the breath you gave them, for them to eat the food you gave them, for them to be like, I guess I gotta go 8 minutes down the street. When he walked up Calvary for you, here's what's funny. People are like, well, daylight savings time, you know, people get tired. If this was an NFL Sunday, I promise you, they wouldn't care. They could do daylight savings times 3 times. Then people be there 3 hours early. Ain't, I promise you, they wouldn't miss no sleep. I'm here, tailgate, game don't start till 4. It's 7:30 in the morning. Who want breakfast? You want some sausage? You want a poker kill box? You want a sausage? What you want? You want the burnt one? I want the burnt one. Don't give me no hot dog that looked like a hot dog. I need a hot dog that looked like it was in a forest fire. Who I'm talking to? Who liked the burnt one? Who put mayonnaise on their hot dogs? Anybody who put mayonnaise on your hot dog, come and get delivered. You weird. You and your family. Ketchup, relish, mustard. But I'm fancy now, okay? I don't live in the hood anymore. It's Grey Poupon. Pardon me. Aventure, switch seats. All right. Listen. Why did I bring up the hot dogs? Like, Pastor, we don't know. Here's why. No, I didn't ask about mayonnaise. I was asking about the hot dogs. But what was I talking about before the hot dog? What? The tailgate. I got caught up by the food. I got caught up. Okay. Got me feeling it. Okay. All right. So, we only talk daylight savings time when it's something we don't really want to do anyway. For y'all to make the commitment to be here makes it clear to God, whether I got my regular hours of sleep or 1 hour less, whatever I have, it came from you, and I'm gonna honor you. And I want to thank God for this church and your love for your King. Now let me hurry and get this word to y'all. Let me hurry and get this word to y'all. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. of our what?
Faith.
He, who's the author?
Jesus.
Who's the finisher?
Jesus.
All right. We are Love Story. Relentless is going bye-bye. We're less than 3 weeks away. We leave what was to what is. The story is changing. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
This is the beautiful thing about a story. If I'm reading, it looks like I don't know what's going to happen, but I know the author. And I know what he thinks about me. So no matter what page I'm on, I know that the best is still coming. I'm trying to help 6 people over there, 3 people at home, and 9 of y'all over here. Did you hear what I said? I don't care where you are in your story. The story is about to get much better. All right. The doctor's report was a commercial. The repo was a commercial. The breakup was a commercial. The program's about to come back on. There always has to be a cliffhanger to make you come back to see what happens. I need you to know, I don't care what happened before the last commercial break. You're about to see what God was planning the entire time. One praise God, one amen. Here comes the elder. You have no... Austin, why is your hand lifted when you were in a head-on collision that almost killed you about 6 weeks ago? Why are you even in here? You're supposed to be dead. Oh, so you on a roll with a miracle who's got his hands lifted, which means if it's on him, we interrupt this regularly scheduled service to bring you an announcement. There's a miracle in the house, and it's on your roll, and it might be you. Tell somebody I'll be back after this commercial. You missed it. Tell them I'm back after the commercial. I don't care what you think about me. I'm gonna be back after the commercial. And they call it a commercial break because the enemy thought what happened would break you. He thought it would break you. The relationship ending would break you. Losing the job would break you. Almost losing your mind would break you. Losing your mother would break you. Losing a loved one would break you. But it was just a commercial. The rest of the program is about to be seen. Jesus was on the cross. It says he endured the cross. That's right, ma'am. Go ahead and shout. I hope you tear up that whole balcony. If nobody else shout, you shout for the whole balcony. I just need a couple crazy people. I don't need a whole church. Just a few of y'all that just think about the goodness of Jesus. And it does. That's right, buddy. I see you in the black shirt. Go ahead, man. He got embarrassed. He's like, he saw me. That was good. Do it again, man. Do it again. Okay, she did it. I love it. I love it. Somebody give me $100. Somebody give me a $100 bill. Quick, 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 quick. Thank you. Come here, young lady. Yeah, you. Come here. Come here. Hurry. Hurry. Run. Run. With endurance, run, run. All you did was be obedient to the man of God, and God had a seed for you. Watch this. And then somebody you didn't know turned around and sowed something else, just like that. Now while you're running back, somebody else is gonna sow, because you don't know what happens when you just go ahead and let it out. When you go ahead and just set it off, when you go ahead and just open your mouth and give God a praise, you don't know what's coming behind it. I need everybody to give God a commercial break praise. Keep going. I'm gonna talk to the people online like this is a timeout at an NBA game. Welcome to the Relentless Lions. This is a home game. Right now, we're in the fourth quarter. Pastor John's got his team running like a well-oiled machine. That worship team came out, played good offense. And then we got Pastor Charles Hall. He's 6'9". He's playing defense, stopping problems from getting to the people. And then we got Miss Marilyn online. She's stopping the enemy through the prince of the power of the air. He's got no authority. And then here comes John Gray, and he's preaching like he lost weight. I don't know what's going on with him, Bob, but he's doing the best he can. Let's look at the slow-mo and the replay from earlier. Praise break. Wow, did he really get into that praise break, Bob? And you know what? He did, because God's been real good to him. Last time I checked, he shouldn't even be alive. He should have been dead last year with a pulmonary embolism. And that's right, and here he is, still married. He should have lost his family too, but his wife's on the front row and his kids are praising God. Maybe that's why he can't just help but praise God. Maybe that's why I can't help but give God the glory. And maybe that's why I don't care what you think about me, because God's been too good. On your mark, get set. You got an enemy who hopes that you bow down right here. But I'm only talking to the crazy praisers. I'm talking to people who've been in the ring, been punched by life, but you got up. Tell somebody, finish. Oh, she's running. Tell somebody, finish. Point number one, you need to have a finishing fight. Put it on the board. Tell somebody it's time to fight. A finishing fight. Somebody say fight. Where's Heather? Did my thing go up? Okay. All right. Finishing fight. We fight the good fight of what? If it's a fight, tell somebody they need to get in the ring. Everybody, come on. Let's go. Some of y'all like. Whatever you gotta do, get off of me. In this corner, hailing from the depths of hell, he's a thief, a murderer, and a liar. He's tried to kill everybody you love and everything you love, and he hoped that you would give up. I need you to get the loudest boo in your spirit for the devil. In this corner, he is the author and finisher of your faith. He is the firstborn of the dead. He is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, and the end. He's known in the streets. Bright and morning star on the block. He's known as the water walker, raising dead people to life. He is the undisputed heavyweight champion of the universe. He was knocked down for 3 days, but he rose with all power in heaven and in earth. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, and everybody online, open your mouth and give honor to the King of Kings and the champion of your soul, Jesus. Tell somebody, fight for it. Tell somebody else, fight for it. Devil, you can't have my kids. You can't have my mind. You can't have my relationships. If I'm single, you can't have my singleness. You can't have my appetite, my affection. You can't have my marriage. You can't have my spouse. I don't care who you got on my job, but you and them are excommunicated. Some things are worth fighting for. Jesus said it is finished on that cross. And if he finished, then you need to have a finishing fight. That means you stay in the ring until you see what he spoke. The Holy Spirit is a mighty burning. I'm sorry, Jeremiah said it's like, did our hearts not burn as he broke down the word of God to us? So the second thing you're going to need if you're going to finish is have a finishing fire. Whew. Somebody say finishing fire. Pastor, what is a finishing fire? A finishing fire means the Holy Spirit is symbolic of fire. That means he cleanses. He cleanses. He removes that which does not cause you to look like Jesus. Oh, I'm almost done, but this is going to bless you. You need a finishing fire. That means, Holy Spirit, burn off anything in me. Watch this. Burn off anything in me and anyone on me. Yeah, some of y'all don't need a breakup. Y'all need an inferno to burn it up. So it can never come back. Ooh. I need a finishing fire. Holy Spirit, purge and cleanse everything that's not like you and everyone that's not like you. And finally, you're gonna need a finishing faith. You need a finishing faith. I ask you and your wife to pray. So tomorrow you need to go look for the thing you just said. A finishing faith means the moment I speak it, I'm already thanking God for it. I don't wait for it to show up because I'm kingdom, not carnal. Notice, carnal doesn't always mean sin. Carnal means short-sighted. Looking only at what you can see with the empirical data and the distance of your physical vision. Carnal-minded is, I believe it when I see it. Kingdom-minded says, I have to speak it, then I'll see it. That was actually a better point. Carnal is, I believe it when I see it. Kingdom is, I won't see it until I speak it. I'm grateful to God that all debts are paid. This is my Jubilee year. Every debt with my name attached is gone. Houses paid off. Lingering debt paid off. I speak it. I praise him because I know I'm going to see it. When Jesus said it is finished in John 19, Jesus was not just speaking of his assignment, but the completion of all things that the Father had in his mind as it pertains to the entirety of the earth. Jesus finished the work. So we're not finishing, we're finished. That's why you should never listen to anybody who looks at your life and says it's over. Oh, no, no, it's not over, it's finished. Because to people, your life should have been over, but what they don't know is before it was ever over, it was finished. Wait a minute, Pastor, I don't understand. When you were a baby, it was finished. Before you ever did one wrong thing, it was finished. So it can't be over when it was already finished before it ever started. Here's where I'm going, Jordan. I'm gonna give you the inner court. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. All right, so who started my story? Who finished my story? Did he give anybody the pen in the middle? Your ex, the teacher, the supervisor, the people that don't like you, yourself, the person that abused you sexually, the people who didn't treat you right in the foster care system, the grandparents, the aunt that couldn't stand you, the other people, your own parents that didn't know how to raise you, all of that, I know it hurt, and I know it was painful, and it felt like it was over, but you need to know that before one thing happened, God had already finished the work. God had already finished everything concerning you. Listen to me. It's only folk that start stuff they can't finish. God has never started anything he didn't finish first. Anybody else, any other church, they would have ran and fell on the ground. God doesn't start anything without finishing it first. That's why you need to read the Bible in Hebrew, because the Bible in Hebrew is read from right to left. For us, it would be backwards, but God always starts backwards, forwards. He starts at the end and speaks from the end all the way to the beginning. God is the original Benjamin Button. That's why I'm not tripping on where I'm at in my life right now, because he wrote this page halfway through from the end. Oh, he writes backwards and puts provision in to get you to the end. You serve the finishing God. The problem with the church is we deal with people based on carnal mindset. You look at some, oh, look at you in sin. Why, look, you nasty. You still struggling with that? Don't judge me based on your story and your chapter. I might be in another chapter in my story, so don't write me off because my story don't look like yours. You got delivered at 20. I'm 50. It took God another 30 years, but I still got free. You smoking weed. Yeah, but you lie. So at least you can smell mine. Yours just... You need to take a drug test. You need to take an integrity test. We always want to throw people away because of the page we walk in on. Scripture says we are to be conformed to the image of the Son. I'm supposed to look like Jesus at the end, not the beginning. If everybody looked like Jesus coming in, you wouldn't need the finished work of the Holy Spirit. You would not need the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit. No, I don't look like Jesus right now the way I will 30 years from now. But I also don't look as bad as I did 30 years ago. Am I talking to somebody? Everyone is standing. Ooh, we getting out early today. I feel the Holy Spirit. If you don't have to leave, don't leave. You're leaving early today anyway. Let me tell you this. There are people who the church world would normally throw away. Love story is throwing no one away. If you want a judgmental, myopic church that tells you everything you've done wrong only, find somewhere else. If you want a church that will give you the full counsel of God, we're not going to play with sin. We're not going to just let you do what you want. No, the word of God says this here. But we also going to walk with you because that's what love does. There's some parents in here right now. You know your kids done stole from you. You still let them in your house. You know the TV did not go away for repairs. The TV is gone. It's been smoked away. It has been snorted away off of the spine of some young model. What? That's the movies. They were like, I don't understand. That's why our church is real safe. They don't even know what I'm talking about. Praise the Lord. We judge people for their addictions without knowing how they got to the symptoms. Love story is not going to do that. I don't care who you are. Jesus wants to interrupt your story since he's the one that wrote it. The only one that has a pen not named Jesus is you. We have free will. Give the Lord the pen back. Let him, by the power of his blood, rewrite the story. Is somebody coming? Somebody's coming already. Oh, she's sewing. She's sewing. That's one of my babies. She's sewing. If you want to be a part of this story, this chapter, meet me right here. If you know that this is the church you need to be a part of, meet me right here. Because the finisher has already completed everything concerning you. Just come back and give him the pen. Here they come. It's a few people that need to make a move today. There's a few people that need to make a move today. Hey, my brother's walking, y'all. He's walking. How old is your son? 2 months. What's his name? Hey, Malachi. It's a beautiful boy, man. That's a beautiful boy. Look at my family coming up here. Somebody else is coming. Welcome home. You hear me? Welcome home. Seen it with my own eyes. Dave, you can lower this. Thank you. Oh, oh, oh. Here comes another one. Here comes another one. Oh, and another one. It's just DJ Khaled in here. And another one. My guy.
Hey, welcome home, my guy.
Ooh, oh. He keeps.
He keeps every promise.
Welcome, sir. Get her hand. Just want to shake your hand. Welcome home. Here's the part I love. The enemy thought y'all was going to stay in your seats. He didn't know what Jesus had written. Is there anybody other than me that's grateful that you serve the finisher? I serve a God who finishes and has always finished what he started. Today, you all have said yes to the author and finisher of your faith. Looking unto Jesus, not people. There are no perfect people. Any church that wants you to worship the pastor is a lie. Stay away. Run from that. That's the devil. That's witchcraft. But if you can find a leader or leaders that are humble enough to say they need the same Jesus that you do, those are some people you can follow. Jesus Christ is the head of the church. Not one man, not one woman, not a pope, not a bishop, nobody. Jesus Christ is the head of the church. His blood is the only thing that can save you. No one else can save you, and no one else is coming. Lift your hands, everybody. Stretch your hands this way. We're going to pray. I want y'all to repeat after me. Say these words. Lord Jesus, it's me. I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that Jesus is Lord. Thank you for the blood that was shed for me. I receive the free gift of salvation, not through my works, but the finished work of the cross. The blood is enough to pay for all my sins. Now, Holy Spirit, come live inside and teach me how to be more like Jesus each and every day. You are my Savior and my Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Family, welcome, welcome, welcome. There's a young brother down here. He came and joined the church today. He brought his 2-month-old son, Malachi. What you don't know is Malachi is the commercial break before the New Testament. Malachi is the last Old Testament scripture. Then there's a 400-year commercial break. And then the programming kicks in with Jesus being born. Your son is the commercial before the second coming of Jesus Christ. You coming down to this altar was not just for you, it was for him. Because God said everybody in your house got saved today. Everybody in your family line is going to heaven. You could not have made a better decision. So everybody's turning this way. We're following Elder Brandon. We're walking with him now. We're celebrating our brothers and sisters as they go. Look at them. Look at them. Clap for them. I don't know what happened today, but God moved in this service. Have y'all been blessed? I'm going to ask you one more again. Y'all been blessed? I love y'all. Who's going to be here for resurrection? Who's going to be bringing people with them? It's love story, y'all. I said it's love story. So we got a couple weeks, and then here come resurrection. I want y'all to prepare. What did I say this week was? A week of what? Acceleration. Watch God increase and accelerate destiny in your life. Watch God move you at a pace that the only people and things that can hold on are those that are assigned. If they're not assigned, the pace that God is moving you at is going to cause them to fall off. So don't kick nobody out. Your pace will remove them. Hands lifted. Now unto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all you can ask, think, or imagine, according to the power that's already working in you. And now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence with exceeding joy, to the only wise God be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you, Relentless Love Story, here and online. Have an amazing week. Maybe hug a few people on your way out the door. We love y'all.